This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and healthful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
So without any further ado, I'd really like to welcome Dr. Blake and thank his wife, Catherine, also for being here with us today.
Diabetes is a progressive disease that can just get worse and worse. Modern medicine manages diabetes, but doesn't cure it, doesn't stop it, and doesn't reverse it. That's the bad news. The good news is that you can do what these people did in this trial and perhaps get the same results that they got. My job today is not to get you to eat differently. That's your job. Only you control what goes into your mouth. My job is to show you what happened in the Marshall Islands. And what happened was the blood glucose. Now, many of you are familiar with blood glucose. Fasting glucose is how most diabetics check their blood sugars. So the idea is when you first eat a meal, you might have some blood sugar higher than normal. But after a few hours, it goes down to kind of its low level, and that's fasting glucose. It should be under 126 milligrams per deciliter, but the average during this trial when they first started it was 236. Extremely high glucose levels. These people were serious diabetics. If you look at the A1C test, they also were really high advanced diabetes people. So that's one thing to think about, that these people weren't beginners at diabetes. They were all really advanced. And some people are up to 400 in their fasting glucose. The thing is that after 2 weeks eating differently, their glucose dropped to an average of 161. It should be down to 126. Now, kind of below 126, you're no longer diabetic, and below 100, you're not even pre-diabetic. And my job today is to tell you how they did it, and your job is to see if you want to do it. This is a look at the medication that people were on in the trial. The three people on insulin, just 2 weeks later, were all off insulin. The other hypoglycemic drugs, there's quite a few. There were 27 people taking blood glucose-lowering drugs, and there were only five. So 22 of the people, plus if you throw in the insulin, that'd be 25 out of the 30 people, after 2 weeks, were no longer taking medication to lower their blood sugar. In fact, they couldn't. This dietary change is so powerful that they had to lower the amount of blood sugar lowering drugs, otherwise people would start, passing out. Their blood sugar dropped too far. So what I'm saying is the diet's really, really powerful. Interesting that most of them dropped off their cholesterol and high blood pressure pills too. So the people were getting well. This happened in the Marshall Islands. The Marshall Islands is kind of, if you look toward the middle of nowhere, that's where they are. There are 6 degrees north latitude. They're far to the west and south of Hawaii. We're at about 21 degrees north latitude. They're at 6. And the temperature is 80 degrees all year long. The elevation is very close to zero all year long. It's a warm, steamy place in the tropics. I want to mention some of the people in the study. Lorak is, I'll read his words. My pilot certificate, medical certificate, was denied when I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. I'm 38 years old. I was devastated, as a certificate is necessary for my work as a pilot. I heard about the diabetes wellness program and I became a participant. I completely changed my diet and began a daily exercise program. Upon my last physical checkup, I was told that I'm fully recovered. My pilot's medical certificate was approved. My fasting sugar is below 90 milligrams per deciliter with no medications. I no longer have diabetes. I have my career and my life back. How did he do that? I'm going to tell you. In America, diabetes is a huge problem. It's the seventh leading cause of death right now in America. It was the sixth, but Alzheimer's moved up to number six and pushed diabetes down to number seven. So it is, generally speaking, a deadly disease, but most people die of heart attacks, which are five times as likely if you're diabetic than if you're not diabetic. And also Alzheimer's disease is much more likely if you're diabetic than if you're not diabetic. So there are some great reasons to reverse diabetes. Other than that, of course, the normal course of diabetes goes from pre-diabetes to diabetes, and then, and you know, I think you all know this if you face this, but I'm going to refresh your memory. Diabetics generally start having their fingers and toes amputated, then maybe their legs go blind, go on dialysis and die. This is the normal medical procedure. You may be able to put that off with drugs for a certain number of years or even decades, but this is what diabetics face, but don't have to, unless, of course, there's a problem with changing the diet. And one problem would be if you're in an institution where you cannot change your diet, or if you're with family members who won't let you change your diet, or if our own habit patterns stop us from changing our diets, which is also very common, too. So type 2 diabetes is the one I'll be talking about today. Type 2 diabetes means your pancreas is still putting out insulin. No problem. You get plenty of insulin. In fact, generally with diabetics, there's too much insulin in the blood called hyperinsulinemia. It just means too much insulin in the blood. So that's not the problem with type 2. The problem is that the insulin is no longer able to get the blood sugar, called glucose, into the cells where it's needed. So if it goes in the cells, you have energy, you feel good, everything's fine. If it stays in the bloodstream, then it creates problems. It damages the nerves, the arteries, the kidneys, the brain, and it's not a good thing. We need to keep that blood sugar down. Now, you can do it with drugs, but it's very difficult for drugs to control it. You know, a little here, a little there, it goes up, it goes down. But our bodies can regulate it very well, and food can regulate blood sugar too. Right food actually regulates it all by itself. Hawaiians are much more prone to diabetes than other races. American Indians are much more prone. The Marshallese people in the study are much more prone. Does that mean that it's inevitable that Hawaiians or Marshallese or American Indians will get diabetes? No, it does not. 60 years ago in the Marshall Islands, the people looked like this. They looked slim, healthy. Diabetes was unknown. It wasn't for lack of doctors or diagnosis, it simply was unknown because the food was different. Same thing in Hawaii. We've all seen Hawaiians of the 21st century. Hawaiians of the 21st century don't look much like this picture, do they? But they look muscular, fit, lean, and it's because of the food that they ate. Traditionally, Hawaiians ate these kind of foods. Foods from the earth, whole foods. Two categories of food that they ate very little of was junk food and meat. So sugary beverages were part of the thing that they would eat. Coconut water has very little sugar in it. Water has no sugar in it. And those are the only two beverages that I know of in the Hawaiian Islands. Something changed. Something has changed in our culture. And this is what's changed. I won't mention any brand names. You all know Uncle Buck in a cluck bucket. Greasy, tasty food that contributes to diabetes. And donuts and sugary drinks and all the sugary junk food snacks, they taste good. Food companies know that if they serve you fat, sugar, and salt, that you'll buy their food and make them rich. And they know that it hurts your health, and they don't care. But we care. I care. You care. So we have to watch out for food that tastes too good and eat food that tastes good in a whole different way. And whole means W-H-O-L-E, different way. It'd be difficult to find a diet that's worse for diabetes than the diet that the local Hawaiians eat, that a lot of local white people eat, or that these people ate. Greasy meats and fast-releasing carbohydrates like white rice, white flour products, sugary things, these are what cause diabetes. These are what contribute to its continuation. And the exciting part is dropping these and substituting other foods can reverse diabetes. So what a lot of Hawaiians eat, white rice, white bread and rolls, donuts, Spam, chicken, ramen noodles, soft drinks, fish, other meats, and salty snacks. These foods provide very little in the way of antioxidants, which I'll talk some more about, but they provide a lot in the way of greasy fats, saturated fats, and also sugary, fast-releasing carbohydrates. As I mentioned, you don't have to have diabetes, no matter what your racial heritage is, and you can probably reverse it no matter what your racial heritage is. It's possible for some people it might not work, but as far as we know, and there are many other studies too, Neil Barnard, you may have heard of, he did some studies on diabetes where he reversed it with a whole food diet, and it's been noticed to be reversed by many doctors around the world. So it does seem quite possible. This lady, Brenda Davis, led a team to Majuro in the Marshall Islands, the capital of the Marshall Islands, and she set up the Diabetes Wellness Project, which is food-based with some exercise and some learning. This is Marie Madison, and to quote her, "When I joined, I could not lift my hands above my head without significant pain. Now I am pain-free. My cholesterol and triglycerides have dropped to normal, and my sugars are almost normal, too. I've lost weight and feel like a new person. I'm now off all medications. It is unbelievable." Many of the people in this study did not think anything would happen. They were skeptical. What happened was habits are hard to break. People are used to their food. So what they did was for 5 hours a day, 4 days a week, they had people come in and make food and train people on how to make food. So they were actually shown what foods to buy, what foods to make, how to prepare them, make them delicious and satisfying, and that's part of the reversal of diabetes. Can you believe that? Now, by the way, I'm not a medical doctor, I'm a scientist. My subject is nutritional biochemistry, so I look at the relationship between food and disease rather than between drugs and disease, and I have a lot more fun because my pills taste good, and theirs don't. My pills have side effects that are good for you and make you feel better, and most drugs have bad side effects and make you feel worse. The road to diabetes, you've all heard that quick-releasing carbohydrates cause diabetes and make it worse. And anyone with diabetes in this room will know that you have to watch your carbohydrates very carefully. You may not have heard that saturated fats also, and perhaps more, are more important in creating and prolonging diabetes than the fast-releasing carbohydrates. Pre-diabetes, when your blood sugar, your fasting blood sugar is between 100 and 126, and your doctor tells you to change your diet, hopefully, and hopefully you do, and it goes back down. I've seen this many times, where people just change their diet. If it gets over 126, your doctor will probably tell you you need to start on drugs, and also will ask you to change your diet. But doctors aren't trained perhaps in the best ways to change diets. Maybe they're not good at recipes or alternatives and substitutions and things. So a lot of people are resistant to change too. We can't lay it all on the doctor's door. I want to talk about the dietary fats for a minute because I think this is an area that has not been covered well in the media, in books, and by medical doctors. If you reduce the saturated fats and trans fats, that increases the amount of blood sugar that can be removed from the blood. So an understanding of type 2 diabetes is that there's plenty of insulin, too much. There's plenty of blood sugar, too much. But it can't get into the cells because the cells are insulin resistant or insulin insensitive. They just won't take it in. Why? Saturated fats and trans fats. Now trans fats generally make up about 1/10 as much of our diet as saturated fats. So the saturated fats are more important. Average American eats 3 times as much saturated fat as unsaturated fat. Really should be the other way around for better health. Dietary saturated fats can reduce the number of insulin receptors. I'm going to show you a little diagram I made for this. But each cell membrane has little receptors or little proteins that span through the membrane, and the insulin locks on, and it few things happen inside the cell, and then the glucose transporter pops up into the membrane and drinks in the glucose. This is what the saturated fats stop. Now, when I say saturated fats, can anyone tell me another word for saturated fats?
Cholesterol?
No, not cholesterol. That's a different substance. It's animal fats that I'm talking about, except for coconut. It's all animal fats that are saturated fats. So in a way, it's probably better that I just come right out and say it. It's animal fats that are causing insulin insensitivity. And I'm going to prove it to you. This study here shows that the saturated fats contribute to excess insulin in the blood, excess blood sugar in the blood, less energy because the sugar can't get in the blood into the cells to make it work. Now, here's another study. This was in Current Alzheimer's Research in 2008. Higher dietary saturated fatty acids interfere with the signaling between the insulin receptor and the glucose transporter, known as GLUT4. This reduces the amount of glucose that can enter the cell and increases the high levels of glucose in the blood. Okay, this is a little drawing that I made. This is the insulin, and this is inside the cell down here, and this is in the bloodstream out here. This is the insulin receptor that spans through the cell membrane. The insulin comes down and locks onto the insulin receptor. And this happens whether there are saturated fats present or not. But this diagram is without saturated fats, the way it should work. The insulin receptor substrate comes up and locks onto the inside of the insulin receptor. It triggers this substance, PI3K, which I'm sure you all know is phosphatidylinositol 3 kinase. I love big words, by the way. But we'll just call it PI3K. That activates protein kinase B, which moves this GLUT4 vesicle up to the cell membrane so the glucose can come in. So I think this is interesting to know how your body works. It's not so simple that the insulin comes and the glucose goes in. There's a few steps. And if you look at it with excess saturated fats, now we're going to call them animal fats, then you see that there are fewer than one half, fewer receptors in the cell membrane, about one half the number of receptors. Right there, you get a dramatic lowering of your body's ability to take the glucose from the bloodstream and put it into the cells, which is exactly what you want. And that's what was accomplished by lowering saturated fat and not having so many fast-releasing carbohydrates during this study. Once it's inside, the insulin receptor substrate didn't lock on properly. The saturated fats interfered there. They interfered with the PI3K, the protein kinase B, and you can see this glucose transporter vesicle did not move to the cell membrane, so the glucose can't get in, which is exactly the problem with type 2 diabetes. So, what could we do to make this all work better? Lower our animal fats. Exactly. It's really simple. So other than that, it's a piece of cake. Wait, don't eat the cake. Now, chromium can also help. There's a special form of trivalent chromium that's found in nutritional yeast and some very high-quality supplements. And this chromium also helps get the glucose from the bloodstream into the cells, and many people are deficient in chromium, which is an essential nutrient that we all need. So that can help, too. Does that mean you can eat all the animal products you want and take a little chromium? No, it doesn't work that way. The Diabetes Wellness Project restored insulin sensitivity in three ways. Well, basically, the first thing, reduce the animal fats. The second thing, slow releasing carbohydrates instead of quick. And the third thing, increase antioxidants in the body to help protect the body. Because it is damage through oxidation that causes the damage to the kidneys, for instance. It sends people to dialysis. And the damage in the bloodstream is largely mediated through free radicals. So the antioxidants in plant foods are very essential. And now, why do I say antioxidants in plant foods? Why don't I just say antioxidants? Because they're only found in plant foods. There are no antioxidants in meat, chicken, fish, eggs, dairy products. The antioxidants are found in plants, and we depend on plants for our antioxidants. We make some in our bodies, too. Okay, now I have 11 steps that they did during this trial, a reversal of pain, having to get up to go to the bathroom a lot of times in the night, and got their blood sugars level, and that means that the risk of heart attack was also reduced, not just down to a normal American risk of heart attack, but even lower because this diet also is very protective of the heart. Refined carbohydrates, step one. You know about this. You know, cakes and things that we don't have out here for you today because I requested and the cook very much cooperated in not having sugary cakes and things for you to eat, because he knew and I knew that it would be bad. You'd feel really good for a minute as your blood sugar shot up, but then start damaging your arteries because your body can't get the blood sugar out into the cells. But what if you ate a very low saturated, low animal food diet for just a few weeks? Then your body would be able to handle the blood sugar spike much better. The insulin would tell the cells would drink the glucose in, no problem. No high blood glucose, and that's how it works. Less refined carbohydrates include sugary drinks. You know what all these things are. Cakes, cookies, crackers, white rice and white flour are two big culprits. You know, white rice absorbs very quickly. That's why we like it, because we feel good after we eat white rice. We get a surge of energy and blood sugar from it. This is what they look like. This is the face of the enemy. Yes, they look good to me too. Do I eat them? No. But I think they look good. I think they would be delicious, and I'd feel good for several minutes after I ate them, and then I'd feel kind of bad for a while. They're lacking in a lot of things like fiber and vitamin E. They lose a lot of their manganese. When white rice or white flour are processed, they lose most of the good stuff, and you wind up with quick calories. Number two, maximize whole plant carbohydrates. Now, if you want to know what whole plant carbohydrates look like, that's what they look like. It doesn't look too bad, does it? There's some beans in there for satisfaction, lots of greens, lots of bulk. You get to eat lots of food, all you want. There's no limit to how much food you can eat on this kind of a diet because all the food's really healthy. So vegetables, fruits, grains, legumes, nuts and seeds, they all are packed with antioxidants. They're all low in saturated fat, and they have carbohydrates, but they're released very slowly. So here's the idea. You eat this meal here, and then over the first 5 minutes after you eat the meal, a little carbohydrate's released. But your body uses carbohydrates all the time, your mind, your muscles, your breathing, everything. So it gets used up as fast as it comes in. The next 5 minutes, a little more carbohydrates released. But your body uses the little more carbohydrates. The next 5 minutes. For hours after you eat this meal, the food regulates your blood sugar. That's why humans were developed to eat this diet. We need this diet. Without this diet, we can't handle the donut diet. Now, you've probably all heard of glycemic index, but the other folks who are diabetic are going to know what glycemic index is. That means that you get the sugar from the food in fast. So some things like brown rice are very slow to get into your bloodstream. That would be good for a diabetic. Some things like white rice are very fast to get in. And the glycemic index and the glycemic load are two ways that we measure them. Blood sugar can spike after a meal if you eat something sugary, or it can rise just a little bit if you eat something that's not too sugary, like this whole food plant-based diet that these people were eating. Here's another graph comparing ice cream and whole grains. You can see that ice cream is going to make you feel really good, but during that high glycemic period in the red, you're also going to have a problem because that's going to be glycating the proteins in your blood, like hemoglobin, and that's what the A1C tests for, glycation. Glycation is a real problem because it causes advanced glycation end products. The glycemic index is very inaccurate. My big problem with the glycemic index is it allows some medical authorities to recommend that you don't eat fruit. But most fruit is really pretty good. If you look at it with a glycemic load instead of a glycemic index, the glycemic index just measures how fast it's absorbed. Watermelon sugar is absorbed very rapidly, so it has a high glycemic index, so you should stay away from it. But the glycemic load takes into account how much sugar there is in watermelon. Very little. So that way you're looking at how much sugar and how fast it goes, so watermelon's perfectly safe. This is a picture of glycemic load, and I wanted to put some fruits in here. The big fat arrow are all low glycemic load fruits that would be suitable. Now, they're loaded with antioxidants. I'll show you some antioxidant scores. Berries especially, and all fruits, really high in antioxidants, protective of all parts of your body, especially your kidneys, your nerves, your bloodstream, your brain. Things that we want to protect. And they're very protective, and they're very slow releasing if you consider how much sugar they have in them. Now, fruit juice is different than fruit. the fruit has fiber that slows down the release of the sugars. So eating an apple is very different from drinking apple juice, which still would be a very undesirable thing for someone with diabetes to do, to drink apple juice, because it's just instant sugars. It's got as much sugar and absorbs as fast as a soda drink. You know, they're about 130 calories each for a cup of either one. But you see here plums, grapefruit, peach, strawberries, sweet cherries, apples, pears, grapes, even papaya is still considered in the safer zone. Papaya is my favorite fruit, and we grow it. I'm glad that everyone can, you know, papayas are loaded with beta-carotene and other carotenoids, which are fat-soluble antioxidants that protect us wonderfully. Here are some slow grains. If the grain is whole, like brown rice, then it's going to absorb very slowly and be perfect. If it's been puffed or flaked or ground up into flour, then it will be a fast grain, like white rice or white sugar, white flour, and puffed grains too. They absorb very, very rapidly. Okay, number four. What they did is had a high fiber diet. Now again, where do you find fiber? What kind of foods don't have fiber?
Animal food.
Meat and chicken, fish and pork and beef and dairy products and eggs, they all have no fiber at all.
But you have to chew them. I don't really understand. You have to chew it so it feels like there's fiber.
They have structure, but they don't have fiber. Fiber would be gums, mucilage, pectins, hemicellulose, or cellulose. And of course, hemicellulose and cellulose are unique to the plant kingdom. And gums and pectins and mucilages are also unique to the plant kingdom. So that's where they're found. And I'm not talking about that sawdust stuff like wheat bran when I talk about fiber. I'm talking about the fiber in food, the soft fiber that makes your stomach work so perfectly. And that's a nice side effect of this diet too. The standard American diet's very low in fiber. As you can see on the top right, I've circled it. The bottom line is how much fiber you should get in a day. And the top line is how much fiber this standard American diet did get in a day. I have a software program that I developed called the Diet Doctor. And the Diet Doctor, you put in what you ate in a day, just like this slide, and it shows you what nutrients you got and how much. So you could track your fiber with this, or you could simply eat plant foods, and you wouldn't need to, because all the plant foods have fiber in them. If we look at a whole food diet, a plant-based diet, we see that the fiber on the right, the top line is how much fiber was gotten in a day, and the bottom line is how much is needed. So a generous, healthy, extra amount of fiber was gotten from eating all the plant foods. So one thing you can do is eat more plant foods, and that's going to be really beneficial and help you. Whether continuing to eat animal foods and adding plant foods will reverse diabetes, I think is quite debatable. These people, in order to reverse their diabetes, get completely off their drugs, really ate no animal products at all for a while. You know, it didn't seem to bother them either. They ate delicious big meals and they were happy. And the viscous fiber is what I've been talking about. I mentioned that already. So there are low fiber foods like white flour and white rice. They still have a little bit of fiber left in them. And then there's foods that have no fiber at all, like oils and sugars and, well, meat, poultry, fish, dairy products, and eggs. These are the foods with no fiber. Very, very bad for your digestion to try and work with foods with no fiber. So a lot of junk foods have very low fiber too. It varies. Also, number five on the 11 parts of our diet was the low fat and better fat. This cat is a fat cat and clearly has been eating too much fat. I didn't want to put a fat human there, so I put a fat cat. And you feel sorry for the poor thing. Too much fat is not good in a diet. About the right amount would be 20 to 25% of our calories as a plant-based fat, like from nuts and seeds or olives, rather than saturated animal fats, which come from, well, animal products. Concentrated fats like butter and liquid oils were not eaten on this diet. Now that may be a big change for a lot of you, like to slather your toast with butter or something. But you know, they make smart butter that doesn't have saturated fats in it, and you always could put on something like tahini made from sesame seeds or peanut butter or almond butter. These are all very low in saturated fats and still plenty tasty on the toast. One trick you can do, instead of using jam, which is too high in sugar, or diabetic jam, which I think tastes terrible, you could just put peanut butter on and then put little blueberries all over it. I figure a blueberry per bite is the way I like it. And that way you're getting the benefit of the blueberry in each bite, and it tastes good. And that's one way to avoid, you know, instead of, say, cream cheese or something that would have a lot of saturated fats. I looked up a lot of different diets and saw how many fats they had. And of course, the standard American diet is very high in fat. Saturated fat should be under 7% of calories. So the green ones are under 7, almost, for Mediterranean. But the red ones, the Atkins diet, the Paleo diet, the South Beach diet, and the transition vegetarian diet. Now, you can have a bad vegetarian diet. I've seen vegetarian diets that were as bad as the worst American diets. All you need to do is eat lots of eggs, cheese, white flour, and there you go. You've got the worst of everything and not enough of the best of anything. So it doesn't mean that you're eating a good diet because you're vegetarian. In fact, you really would need to transform that vegetarian diet just a little more by not eating the eggs and the cheese and the other dairy products, and then you'd have a really healthy plant-based diet. So looking at the diets, the Mediterranean diet almost got low enough. The saturated fat, you know, came from olive oil. You know, olive oil has a little saturated fat, but they're eating 3 tablespoons a day, so it added up to boost their sat fats a little bit above the 7%. With the plant-based diets, you see very little saturated fat. Even on this raw food plant-based diet, 45% of their calories came from fat, but only 6% from saturated fat. That's because they ate a lot of nuts and seeds, which are high in fat, very low in saturated fat. I consider nuts and seeds to be a very healthy food. So, low saturated fat, I said that. Sources in typical American diets are cheese principally, and then all the usual culprits that you all know about: hamburger, bologna, spam, whole dairy fat, and butter. Eggs aren't too high in saturated fat, but of course they have very high amounts of cholesterol, and when cooked, the oxidized cholesterol contributes to the damage to the kidneys and bloodstream. So eggs weren't eaten on this diet either. And trans fats were left out of this diet. Of course, trans fats are generally found in junk food, cookies, crackers, cakes, that sort of thing, from hydrogenated oils. But did you know there's two other sources of trans fats? That's beef and dairy products have trans fats. The cows can biohydrogenate the oils in their rumen, in their stomachs, and transform it into trans fatty acids, the same trans fatty acids that are made in the factory where they take liquid oils and bubble hydrogen through them with a cobalt catalyst and make trans fats that way. This is Tinar Kiona. When I joined this program, I was very skeptical, but very quickly I started to feel better. The cramps in my legs disappeared and I no longer had to get up during the night to go to the bathroom. My sugars kept dropping and are now normal, without any medication. My last lab test showed that I am no longer diabetic. People can hardly believe what has happened to me. That's a nice story, isn't it? So she ran into this program. She said, yeah, I will completely change my diet. She was having leg cramps at night. She had to get up every hour to go to the bathroom. She was in pain a lot of the time. And by changing her diet, all of that went away, along with all the drugs and her higher risk of death from everything else. And I like that she was skeptical. She didn't think it would work. But she did it anyway because she was desperate, and it did work. And she's glad she did it. Sources of trans fats in the American diet, from the USDA, we get about 21% of our trans fats from either dairy products or beef. Goat also has that trans fats in it, whether it's goat cheese or yogurt or goat meat too. Animals with rumens do. Pigs, for instance, do not make trans fats. Not an endorsement for pork, though. A little high in saturated fats, unfortunately, to be healthy. Now, omega-3 fatty acids you've probably heard of, and oftentimes people think of fish, but in this diet, people got their omega-3 fatty acids from walnuts or flax seeds, sometimes from hemp seeds, or, well, leafy greens don't provide much. In fact, if you wanted enough of your omega-3s from leafy greens, you'd have to eat a 5-gallon bucket of raw greens, which any horse can do in a day, but not many humans. So you really do need either walnuts, pecans are also good, or flax seeds ground up quickly, you know, in a coffee grinder, and then top things off. Make sure to get these. These have an impact on the cell membranes too, to help the glucose get inside the cell where you need it, so you don't feel tired all the time, instead of in your bloodstream where you still feel tired, but it's burning up your circulation and your nerves. Okay, number 9 out of 11 was plant antioxidants. I've talked a little bit about these. The antioxidants we find in plants, let's see, the carotenoids, which some of which we can transform into vitamin A, and the major source of vitamin A in most humans on planet Earth is from plants, the carotenoids, actually the carotenes, being transformed into vitamin A. So let's look at the standard American diet. The vitamin C is very low. It should be here, it's way down here. The vitamin E, very low. It should be up here, but it's way down there. The other antioxidants are quite low too in an American diet. If we look at a plant-based diet, then we're seeing that the vitamin A, because of all those carotenoids, is super high compared to the RDA. The vitamin C, super high. The vitamin E, high, because nuts and seeds are added. By the way, sunflower seeds are an excellent source of vitamin E, the alpha-tocopherol fraction, and walnuts provide the gamma-tocopherol fraction. Of vitamin E is a family of different tocopherols, and they're all important. Gamma is even more important, the gamma-tocopherol type of vitamin E, for protecting the brain. You can see 2 servings per day of beans were given, as many fruits and vegetables as possible, nuts, seeds, and a little bit of whole grains, usually in the intact whole form. Like quinoa can be cooked very quickly into a nice whole grain, kind of high protein, satisfying dish. It cooks very quickly and it's tasty and satisfying. It's really best to get your antioxidants directly from food. That's the best way. And I wouldn't want anyone to think that they could eat food low in antioxidants and take a supplement and get away with it, because it's not going to work. You really need the food antioxidants. They still have things in them that we're discovering. There are hundreds and hundreds of carotenoids, and there are more that we don't know about. And there are polyphenols, hundreds of those, and more that we don't know about. So we're always going to need the food as our first line of defense for antioxidant action. It is possible to get good antioxidants from supplements, but it's very unlikely. Doctors and pharmacists are agreed. Vitamin supplements, especially antioxidants, are worthless or worse. Health food store clerks are completely agreed. Vitamin supplements are great and make you healthy. So who's right? They're both wrong. The problem is the vitamins are so poorly made. Instead of using the ascorbated form of vitamin C, they use ascorbic acid. And the ascorbic acid is very irritating to your stomach. Not much of it gets absorbed, so you're not getting the goodness from it. Instead, you're getting an irritated stomach. The vitamin E is terrible. It's synthetic alpha-tocopherol instead of the natural form of all 4 tocopherols. So because they go cheap and give you supplements that are very bad for you, it doesn't mean that all supplements are bad. It just means that most supplements are worthless. In one study on vitamin E, the synthetic form, I checked, they actually found a 4.5% increase in mortality rather than a decrease. Now, this was with Finnish smokers and asbestos workers, so they weren't normal people. They were heavy smokers or asbestos workers. But still, had they used real vitamin E or the good form of vitamin C or a full spectrum of carotenoids instead of just beta carotene, they would have found much better results. And so I would encourage you to be very picky about your vitamin supplementation if you're going to take any at all. And start with the food, make that the basis of your antioxidants. And what type of food has antioxidants? Plant foods, very simple. And all the animal foods don't, so it makes it pretty simple to choose. You can rate antioxidants in food with this FRAP score. Walnuts, pomegranates, wild blueberries, and other berries came up top. With the BRAC score, small red beans floated to the top. So some of those beans have tremendous antioxidants, not soybeans, because they're white and they don't have as much, but soybeans are very good for you too. All of the beans are really healthy foods. So number 10 is to cut down on the damaging things, oxidants in our food. Pesticides are found in food, and it'd be best to avoid them. And there are pesticides in plant foods and animal foods, But the persistent organic pollutants, the fat-soluble ones, tend to concentrate in the animal fat. So that may be the more dangerous ones of them. They're hard to avoid in our society. When you cook things at high temperatures, you get heterocyclic amines, advanced glycation end products. It's really better not to eat Uncle Cluck in a bucket because of that high temperature frying. High temperature frying, although it tastes good, is not healthy because you get heterocyclic amines, you get all these long words that wind up just meaning unhealthy. So on this diet, they did not fry foods. They lightly sauteed foods, but they didn't fry them hard till they turned brown. And that really lowered some of the bad things in them. Now, ones I read studies, and I read about 10 studies a day, and these are the original studies in medical journals, and I have thousands of them that I've saved. You might find sometime where one study shows that something has doubled the number of cases of diabetes or tripled the number of cases of diabetes. It'd be very rare. This study found that some food, this one food, did your risk of diabetes of these people in the National Health Examination Survey, the NHANES, 38 times more likely to get diabetes. 38 times is just a huge number. And the problem was because fish swim around and absorb these persistent organic pollutants, polychlorinated biphenyls, dioxins, DDTs, DDE, its breakdown product. I could run out of breath talking about them. But anyway, lots of bad things that increase the risk of diabetes. So that means that even fish aren't a perfectly safe food. Now, in general, I consider them much safer than other animal foods, and yet not perfectly safe. So in this diabetes trial, no fish were eaten either, in order to avoid the pollutants. Okay, the last thing they did on this diet was moderate salt. So that helped. This is how they did it. They basically fixed food. They're little bento boxes, but instead of having greasy meat and white rice, they had healthy food in the bento boxes, and they showed everybody how to do it with cooking classes. They had dinner classes. So basically, the people were in class all day, so they wouldn't go out and eat donuts and Spam and all the other junk, and got trained to eat good food for a while and get used to it and get to like it. And here's the catch. After a while, after a week or two, these people had less pain. They had more energy. Their sight got better. You know, diabetic retinopathy is a terrible problem with diabetes, where your eyes, you go blind. So they were having some really good results of less muscle cramps at night. So once they got to the results part, only 2 weeks, they started saying, you know, I like this diet. I feel better. I can sleep through the night. You know, this is good. Here's a cooking class, cooking along, learning how to make food, how to prepare it. Making food yourself is, of course, the best way, but as we see from today's feast, the chef here at Rosalani can also make some perfectly healthy food for you. This is a shopping tour. Going to the store, learning which foods are safer and which aren't. Now, I gave this talk at a health food store in town, I won't mention which one, and I said, can you have healthy whole grain crackers here in front of me so I can show people? She brought up three boxes, and when I read the ingredients, all of them said whole grain on the front, and none of them were anything but white flour. So it is unfortunate that most of the foods that you see that say whole on the front, breads, crackers, that stuff, usually isn't true. Yeah, if the first ingredient is wheat flour, you might think it means whole wheat flour, but it doesn't. It means white flour. Wheat flour means white flour. Whole wheat flour means whole wheat flour. They had some exercise program going on with this trial, and I think it's very helpful. I encourage all of us to get more exercise. I'm very much hoping to get a run in later today. I've been on a running program for a couple years, and it really improves my health. You can't fight a bad diet with exercise, but it certainly makes you feel better in every way. And these people got out walking twice a day. Okay, nothing fancy, not far, not fast. But they did a little bit maybe of dance or workout room, weight training or boxing. They did a little bit of exercise. And believe me, these Marshallese people, with their climate and nothing to climb, they're just not a real exercise-based people. Here are the ladies out for their walk. having a good time. They're some of the sweetest people I've ever met in my life. I mean, I don't know if it's racial or the climate or what, but the people in the Marshall Islands are so sweet, really nice people. Here the men are working out with a jump rope, and the women are doing hula and other dance. A lot of these things you can get free classes around. Here are the boys posing with their weights. They're not as vigorous as you would think, and you don't have to think that you have to do a lot of exercise to make this work. If you just changed your diet and did no more exercise, you know what would happen? The food would make you lighter on your feet, and you'd feel like moving more. Isn't that interesting? You know, I eat a heavy steak. What do you want to do after that? Hit the Barca Lounger deep. Raise the legs. So there's also a lecture program. So we had lifestyle and chronic disease, food and nutrition like this talk today, gardening, exercise, stress management, some special classes for diabetics on teeth and foot care, because diabetics can have special problems with their teeth and with their feet. The two-week transformation, this is the good part. Pain disappeared in the joints and the arms and especially the legs. This is why the people who stayed on the diet, because the pain went away. This is the part you can see. See, diabetes is silent. It doesn't hurt, except in the legs and the arms or the joints. They no longer needed leg massages at night, and they didn't have to get up all the time to go to the bathroom, had more energy. Walking became easier. They no longer constipated. Their whole body is functioning at a higher level, in fact, younger. And I challenge you, any of you who want to try this for, you know, 2 weeks solid, you are going to find that you're going to feel younger, not older. Now, I'm a mere 64 years old, so I'm probably on the younger side of most folks in this room. But I feel younger because of the diet that I eat, and I do eat this diet. I don't eat junk food. I do eat plant foods. I don't eat meat and dairy products. And it feels really good to me, and I feel like I look forward to every meal and I enjoy every meal. So it's not the end of life as you know it, to change to a plant-based diet. Of course, I have my wife, Catherine, who's a great cook, and that really helps. So I showed you this amazing drop in blood glucose. I mean, is there anyone in here whose fasting glucose is above 200? No. Okay, so if your fasting glucose isn't above 200, and it dropped 100 like it did in this trial, it'd be under 100. You'd be done. Diabetes over. You have to adjust your medications of care. I want to caution you. Should one of you be so eager that you're going to say to yourself, I'm going to try Steve's diet. I'm going to start today. Watch out. You're going to need to have your medications changed very frequently. If you really went to a complete change of diet, you might need to see your doctor, get your blood drawn every 3 days in order to keep up with it. Otherwise, your high blood pressure medication would push your blood pressure too low. Your high blood sugar medication would push your sugar too low because they're no longer needed. So just that's a caution in case you go wild and want to do it that way. The people who continued the program and ate like the top picture continued the benefits. Some people went to the bottom picture, went back to donuts, to greasy meats and white rice. Their diabetes came back just as bad as it was before. But what does this tell you? This is under your control. You can turn it on and you can turn it off. It's not a doctor, it's not me. It's you who are in control of this. Here's Fred Heine. I suffered a stroke because of my diabetes and was in a wheelchair. I could not walk. After joining the diabetes wellness program for 6 months, I got rid of my wheelchair and I'm now walking on my own again. I'm healthier than I've been in many years. The program has given me more than I ever thought possible. It provides the people of the Marshall Island with the greatest hope we have had. Nice to see someone getting rid of a wheelchair. This is Morrison Lautej. He's also a pilot. I was diagnosed with diabetes in 1994. I had to take pills every day. My weight kept going up, as did my blood glucose level. I joined the diabetes wellness program, and I feel great now. I have no more pain, no more sleepless nights, no more cravings of unhealthy food. It's nice to hear, isn't it? If you completely switch, the cravings go away. But if you keep the little bit of junk food, then you still have the junk food cravings. I know. I have them too. I have a whole different outlook on what I put into my body. I pray that the diabetes wellness program will continue until all people with diabetes feel as well as I do. Isn't that sweet? If there's hope in the Marshall Islands for curing diabetes, believe me, they have no soil. They have no fruit. Their vegetables are terrible. Here, we have everything we need to do a beautiful job. You can go to any one of a number of stores all within a couple of miles and get piles of fruits and vegetables all you want. You can get the whole grains. They have health food stores. You can get nuts and seeds all you want. They can't. I mean, when I went there, I was really distressed at how bad the food was. So it's up to you, not me, not your doctor, but just you. If you decide you want to reverse your diabetes the same way these people did, you could give it 2 weeks and see if it reversed. You could give it 2 months and do it a little bit slower. You could give it 2 years. But don't give it too long, because diabetes does have the complications that I don't want any of you to suffer from. Well, that's the end of our talk. You all stayed awake. Thank you so much. Any questions? Okay, so your question is coconut oil. Is it true the book titled says The Miracle of Coconut Oil? The other book, Drugstore in a Bottle, is that true? No, it's really not. I have a cute little book here. I call it my fat book because it's really fat and heavy. It's all about dietary fats and oils, saturated fats, trans fats, omegas, all that stuff. I have a good time with understanding dietary fats and oils. So there are three saturated fats that have been proven to clog the arteries: lauric, myristic, and palmitic acids. They're all exactly the same. They're just 12 carbons, 14 carbons, or 16 carbons in length. The three saturated fats that clog our arteries up. Coconut oil is 40% lauric and 25% of the myristic and palmitic, totaling 65% of the artery-clogging fats, thereby winning first place as artery clogger. But guess what else they clog? The cell membranes, so the sugar can't get in. So the saturated fats from coconut oil are going to increase your risk of diabetes, just like eating twice as much meat would, because the saturated fat is 84 to 92%, whereas butter and lard are about 50%. In other words, twice as bad. Also, I rate good fats because they have vitamin E, which coconut oil has none. It's rare among plants to have none. And I also like to look for other things in fats and oils, but none of the good things are in coconut oil and all of the bad things. So I would say if you rated all the oils in the world from the healthiest to the least healthy, then coconut oil would be the least healthy of all. And why are people saying it's healthy? To sell it.
Money.
Yeah, good old money. I am really interested in your health and not in selling stuff. Oh, what kind of oil? Well, first of all, it's good to use very little oil. If you're going to, for instance, top a salad, instead of using an oil, if you grind up some nuts, walnuts, or sunflower seeds in a blender, throw in a few things, my wife's cookbook tells you how to make different dressings, that's much healthier. When the oils are extracted from the seed or the bean, oh boy, they heat them, they grind them, they put in chemicals, they strip out lots of good things like lecithin and vitamin E, and they add bad things like pollutants, bisphenol A from the plastic, and basically it's better always to get your fats and oils from nuts and seeds or olives or avocados. Excellent. Avocado makes a nice salad dressing too, rather than getting the oils. But because when oils get heated and rancid, then they have the capability of causing what's called lipid peroxidation, which causes malondialdehyde, which can cause DNA adducts, which can cause cancer. So this is the reason why fried foods should be lightly sautéed and not heavily fried or deep fried, because it can increase your risk of cancer, and it does. Any other questions? Okay, well, I think we're done. Diane, would you like to announce the thing? Thank you so much. Have a good time. I hope you did too.
Thank you. This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.